But that means you have to sing twice as loud, okay? Don't yell, but sing twice as loud. Cindy says, no, okay. Okay, lots of things going on, but why don't we greet each other in the name of Jesus Christ this morning? Okay, if you could take your seats. Stand up, though, of course, because we're... Take your seats, yes. Yeah, but stand up, and please don't take them anywhere. It's been a really long week. All right, let's just praise the Lord. I'll just shut up.
Lost our Savior, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned, feel no shame at the sound of your great name. Every fear has no place. Great name, Jesus, worthy.
stars came crashing down in tiny pieces to the ground. I was all alone down here, trapped beneath the atmosphere. Then I thought somebody called my name. I spun around and caught a flame. I gave it to a God I didn't know. And now everything is falling into place. A brand new life is falling, and I owe it all to grace. It's so much brighter living in your world. Say what you did for me. You gave me something I want everyone to see. When we stumble and it all goes wrong, only you can make it right. So I say, oh, I'm learning to be the light. Oh, oh, I'm learning to be the light. Oh, when the heart is cold as ice, you can't melt it with advice. No one wants to listen to a list of things they shouldn't do. So I build a city on a hill, and I light a candle on a sill, knowing you'll be always knocking at the door. Oh God, I just want to love on everyone. All I have is yours to give, so let the people come. So much brighter living in your world. Save what you did for me. You gave me something I want everyone, I mean everyone, to see. When we stumble and it all goes wrong, only me can make it right. So I say, oh, I'm learning to be the light. Oh, oh, I'm learning to be the light. Oh, oh, I'm learning to be the light.
Amen. Be seated. As we go to our time of prayer today, we want to remember, there are four prayer shawls up here on the altar. So when we go to prayer, if you would like to come and pray on those shawls, that would be wonderful. They are going to Madge Flack, Barbara Parks, Robert Brown, and Howard Seckel. Howard is doing well. He had a blood clot in his leg last Sunday, was in the hospital, but and then they found more blood clots. So just remember him. Lucille Copus went into the hospital on Wednesday night, and Johanna took her, or called the squad. They went in, and then I went in to remain with George, and we didn't get home till 2:30, so it was a little later in that next morning. But Lucille had the flu, and she was so confused. She was so dehydrated. It was bad. But she was supposed to get out last night. I saw her last night. Then they were waiting for the potassium to finish, and then she was supposed to go home. Rita Brucci is in the hospital. She has had cellulitis a few weeks ago. She got home, and now it spread from her legs up into the stomach area. So I didn't even know it could do that, but there you go. So she's going to be in the hospital for a while. And let us remember Mary Fox. Mary's daughter has been diagnosed with breast cancer. And not only that, but Mary, she goes to a rheumatologist quite regularly. And they did some regular blood work and found that she tested positive for tuberculosis. totally weird. She didn't believe it, didn't understand it, but her own doctor confirmed that. So she has an appointment. She doesn't like to drive out of Marion. So I said, Mary, I'll take you to Riverside on Monday. So I'm going to take her down, and we'll see what the see what the doctor says, but that's why she hasn't been around. So let us remember her, because you don't often hear of TB, and she has no idea how she would have got it. So prayers that it's not floating around there, that would not be good. Also, prayers for Christiana. Most of you probably got the prayer chain, but on Tuesday, the first day they went back to school after the shooting, the boy who was shot, Logan, is their gym helper. You know how high school students are helpers, aides in classes, and he was the gym aide. So the kids and Christiana decided they were going to make a video and send it to him. The kids were so excited, and she sent us the clip of the security film from the gym. But the kids are sitting down, there's some doing exercises. She's filming, and she steps back. There's a kid behind her. It was his birthday that day, too. Tripped over him, landed on her arm, and she's broken her elbow. So it's just crazy. So Hannah was supposed to be here, but she had to go get Christiana's dog yesterday because she just can't take care of it with her left hand. She's right-handed, so... Anyway, lots of things going on in the world and in our lives, right? So let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. And anybody who wants to come and pray over the prayer shawls, please come. Oh Lord our God, we are here today solely to worship you, to listen to you, to hear and to feel the love that you have for each of us. Lord, first of all, we ask you to pour out your love upon these prayer shawls as they go out to people who need that extra hug from you. As they put these shawls around them or on them, we pray that they can be filled with your love, filled with your grace, and feel that power coming into them for healing. Lord, you have heard our prayer requests already. And we pray, Lord, that you will lift up and touch each of those we mentioned. We ask you to continue to touch the students at West Liberty School, and Logan and Eli, for healing, both physically and mentally and spiritually. Lord, you are a great God. You do not ask very much of us, only that we worship you and you alone, and that we trust and obey. We're not very good at that. And you love us anyway. Lord, send your spirit down upon us this morning so that as we leave here, we can feel empowered to go out into the world and to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. Be with those all around the world, Lord, who are suffering, who are hungry, those in the middle of war-torn countries, those who don't have enough food, those, Lord, who have the means but don't make the effort to come and worship. We pray for the homeless, for people who have lost jobs, for those who are caught under the influence of addiction. We will remember all those who serve, not in our country, but all across the world in the armed forces, the police, the fire department, all those who are in public service. And we pray for ourselves, Lord, that you will come down and lead us to be the light in the middle of Marion. And Lord, we lift up to you now the prayer that you taught us as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
Come home, you're not too
If you're able, please stand for the reading of the scripture today, which comes from 2 Kings 17. The Lord warned Israel and Judah through all his prophets and seers, "Turn from your evil ways. Observe my commands and decrees in accordance with the entire law that I commanded your fathers to obey, and I delivered to you through my servants, the prophets. But they would not listen, and were as stiff-necked as their fathers, who did not trust in the Lord their God. They rejected his decrees and the covenant he had made with their fathers and the warnings he had given them. They followed worthless idols and themselves became worthless. They imitated the nations around them, although the Lord had ordered them, do not do as they do. And they did things the Lord had forbidden them to do. So the Lord was very angry with Israel and removed them from his presence. Only the tribe of Judah was left, and even Judah did not keep the commands of the Lord their God. They followed the practices Israel had introduced. Therefore, the Lord rejected all the people of Israel. He afflicted them and gave them into the hands of plunderers until he thrust them from his presence." This is the word of God from long ago for the people of God today. Thanks be to God. Let's pray. Lord, as we are gathered here, those words are so hard for us to hear. And yet, we can hear God saying those very words to us this day. Lord, we want to be faithful. We need to be faithful. So show us how, and let us just trust and obey, like David did, like Abraham, Jacob. Guide us, we pray. Amen. That scripture is kind of hard to hear, isn't it? So God rejected all his people and left them to plunder, as the scripture said. 209 years the prophets warned the people. We're talking about the kingdom of Israel right now. Remember, they're split, so this is the northern country. 209 years. And finally, as in a game of hide and seek, God says, time's up. You can't hide from me any longer. So God used the king of Assyria to come in and totally take down the whole of the northern kingdom, Israel. There was nothing left. They were taken to Assyria and they were spread out. And what eventually happened was they started marrying the people of Assyria. And all of those 10 tribes were lost. Lost forever. You've heard of the lost tribes of Israel? That's them. They're gone. No more roots, no more leaders, nothing. And they began to worship other gods. I'm sure they also, every now and again, worship God, but only when it seemed fitting to them. There is no more Israel. So what's God doing? Last week, I told you that God has now abandoned all the whole nation, the 12 tribes that he brought together, and he's focusing on one tribe, Judah. It's actually two, Judah and Benjamin. I'm going to keep saying that. So right around Jerusalem, and he's betting on all these people, as it were. These will be his people. They're the only tribe left to spread the ways of the Lord our scripture said. God can't make us, cannot make us do anything. He wants us to love him freely, which is why we have free will. But God will also allow us to deal with the consequences of sin, not only our own sin, but the sin of generations and decisions before us. That is what's happening in our scripture. God doesn't cause the kings of Assyria to come in and take all the Israelite people. It is a result of the choices they made, the decisions to serve other gods, other things. So many people say, I can't believe in God because God did this. No, God did not do this. People have done this. So what's happening in the kingdom of Judah? This is where I would have wanted to live had I been an Israelite. There were 38 kings. Oh, and by the way, in the kingdom of Israel, do you remember I said they didn't have one good king? Not one. In 209 years, not one good king. They all did evil in the sight of the Lord. Out of the 38 kings in the kingdom of Judah, there were only five good kings. Five out of 38. That's pretty sad, isn't it? And this is God's chosen people. No wonder God was angry at them. The prophet Isaiah, around this time, is writing warnings to the people of Judah as well as Israel. His story, if you read through the book of Isaiah, and it's very difficult to read, which is why we just had snippets of it in our chapter this week. He spreads doom and gloom. That's what I call him, the doom and gloom prophet. It all seems bad. It's words of judgment. But there's also words of comfort kind of woven into his writings. And that's because Isaiah is prophesying what is going to happen hundreds of years down the road. He prophesies, if you remember, we read Isaiah at Christmas time. He prophesies that on down the road, there is going to be sent a Messiah, a Savior, who will come and save them. The songs that we sang today reflected that. That last song, I love it. The sorrow in all of our lives, there's sadness, there's hurt, there's pain. And yet, God is still there. So about 100 years after the kingdom of Israel falls, the kingdom of Judah will fall also. But they fall to the Babylonians. Why 100 years later? Because there are two good kings during this time. One was Hezekiah. We read his story. And the other one is Josiah. They have watched the northern kingdoms fall. And God has said through the prophets, not only to the northern kingdom, but also to the southern kingdom, is anyone listening? Is anyone listening? It's easy for me, well, it's not easy, but I do stand up here on Sunday mornings and I speak to you. I could ask, how many of us really listen in the song, in the prayers, in the sermon, in the scripture? And that's a good question. Because according to statistics, only 33% of any listening audience actually listens. I'll tell you, if there was even one person who heard the message today, I would have done the job that God called me to do, right? It's the same for you as you go out into the world and you touch people that I cannot possibly touch. The things you do, the things you say, the things you don't say, the things you don't do, all speak. They prophesy to people. As the northern kingdom was falling, the king of Assyria decides he wants to come and take over Jerusalem as well. I mean, after all, their borders are just right together. He may as well take the whole land, right? Do you remember what happens? He sends a commander down who stands outside the gates of Jerusalem and starts yelling this message from the king of Assyria. It's nothing but lies, deceit, false promises. You know, if you give in, we will give you this, this, and this. False promises. And then he starts preaching, if you will, that the God they serve is not a God at all. It hasn't been long since the Baal prophets that we talked about last week have all been killed, but they don't remember that. And King Hezekiah tells his people, don't listen to these words. Is anyone listening? We have to listen to the right voice, the right words. So Sennacherib sends King Hezekiah a letter. Hezekiah takes the letter and he goes right into the temple, doesn't make any decisions, into the temple, lays the letter on the altar, and he prays this prayer. O Lord, God of Israel, enthroned between the cherubim, you alone are God over all the kingdoms of the earth. You have made heaven and earth. Give ear, O Lord, and hear. Open your eyes, O Lord, and see. Listen to the words Sennacherib has sent to insult the living God. It is true, O Lord, that the Assyrian kings have laid waste these nations and their lands. They have thrown their gods into the fire and destroyed them, for they were not gods, but only wood and stone, fashioned by men's hands. Now, O Lord our God, deliver us from his hand, so that, get this, so that all kingdoms on earth may know that you alone, O Lord, are God. I think that is a prayer that we need to pray today. So that all kingdoms on earth, all nations, all people may know that the Lord our God is God alone. That is the king's prayer. What a wise king. He gets sick, but a prophet comes, Isaiah comes and tells him, because you have been faithful, because you have prayed, your life will be extended by 15 years. Wow. Because God wanted him to lead the people in his faithfulness. Hezekiah has not lost sight of the reason that God called one nation in the first place. Do you remember what that was? Two reasons. One, to worship one God, God alone. And the second was to let all nations know that he is God. After King Hezekiah comes King Josiah, 8 years old when he takes the throne. During his reign, he finds a book stuffed away somewhere, and it's the book of the law. It hasn't been used. It's the Old Testament. It's the law of Moses. And when he finds it, he gets so excited. He knows that it is something important. He calls all the people out in Jerusalem, and they stand and read it from beginning to end. Wow. And the people change their hearts and look toward the Lord again. After King Josiah dies, Isaiah is still around, and God is calling him to go out and to prophesy. Isaiah says that he's not worthy. And God speaks to him, and in a vision, he sees angels come with hot coals to put on his lips. That would hurt. But they cleanse his lips and take away his sins. And then he hears a voice say, "Whom shall I send? Who will go for us?" And instead of running away, Isaiah says, "Here I am. Send me." He didn't come up with a list of complaints or excuses like Moses did. You know, Moses said he stuttered, so he couldn't speak for God. Isaiah said, "Here I am. Send me just as I am. You're going to empower me. I may not have very many skills and gifts, but you, God, will empower me. All I have to do is to be willing." Do you remember last week when I said, look out, because we're going to be asking for volunteers, and instead of looking at the floor, this is what I want you to do. I want you to stand and say, "Here I am, send me." Not because I ask or because someone else asks or a committee, but because you want to do what God is calling us to do. Are we listening? This story today is our story. 3,000 years later, the question has not changed. Are we listening to God? Many of us say, but where is God? Where was God in last week's shooting at West Liberty? God's evidence was everywhere. The shooter, who had been in the bathroom, took a shotgun to school. He disassembled it, put it in his book bag. He drove his sister to school. His sister knew nothing. And then he went into the bathroom and very quietly reassembled it in one of the bathroom stalls. He heard the bell ring, and then he started to exit the bathroom. And that's when Logan walked in. There were students lining the hallway ready to go on a field trip, and Logan had decided he needed to go to the bathroom. He got shot twice. The bathrooms didn't have doors, they're just openings, you know, where you walk in and around. A teacher who was in the hallway too saw a flash and instantly knew that came from a gun. The kids thought it sounded like firecrackers. And the teacher yelled, "Intruder." Immediately, the kids all ran back into the classrooms, barricaded the doors, smashed out windows, and ran. After Eli had shot Logan, he stepped out of the bathroom, and his intent was to kill hurt as many people as he could. He shot at the classroom doors. Another student was injured with the glass coming off the doors, cut him. Where was God? God was all over the place. One person injured. And then Eli retreated back into the bathroom, and Logan, laying bleeding on the bathroom floor, talks him down. "You don't want to go to jail. You don't want to take my life. You don't want to take anyone else's life." And he talked him down. And I don't know if this was in the news or not, but Eli at that point surrendered the gun, gave it to Logan laying on the floor, gave him the gun and said, put the barrel to his chest and said, shoot me. And Logan said, no. Your life is worth living. And then a teacher came in and he surrendered the gun. The fact that Logan hadn't been in a public school at all in his life until this year, God sent him to that school because he had a purpose for him. Where was God during the stabbings at OSU earlier? Well, that was before Christmas, wasn't it? That could have been so much worse. 9 people injured, no one killed. God was there. Where's God in all the overdose victims in Ohio? God's working. He's raising up leaders all around to help deal with this terrible, terrible addiction that is going on. Law enforcement needs to get to the source of the drugs coming in to Ohio. Where's God in all the natural disasters that we're hearing about? God's there. Slowly, stories come out of people who may have lost everything, but they have their lives. And this is why God remains faithful at all times, always. God's thoughts and God's ways are higher than our own. We do not understand why things are happening in the world, but God sees the bigger picture. Why wouldn't we trust a God like that? And yet we try to do life on our own. The kingdom of Judah, unlike the kingdom of Israel, when they're taken over by the Babylonians, they're taken en masse to Babylonia. The rich and the wealthy and the smart are all kept together and they're integrated into their culture. But because they're together, very slowly they begin to realize what they've left behind. They begin to realize that they were the chosen people of God, that they screwed up. It is actually during this exile in Babylon that most of the Old Testament is written. Because they realize, we don't have this in writing. How are we going to pass this on? There is a possibility that there will be no Israelites left at all. Maybe I should say Judahites. And so they start writing things down. The Babylonians don't oppress the tribe of Judah. They encourage their thinking. In fact, it is thought that from these people who were taken to Babylon, the influence of their writings, that's where the 3 wise men came from. And they would have had the writings of the people who came in captivity to lead them. When we are threatened, when we face death, we want to preserve our way of life. We want to pass on what we know and believe to others urgently. That is what was happening here to the Israelites who are now in Babylon. We, in the population of the people in Marion, and I mean we and other churches, have become a minority. Christians have become a minority. And it is time that we stand up and, like Isaiah, we say, "Here I am, Lord. Send me." Or better still, send us together. God promised never to leave us and never to forsake us. That's what those Israelites in Babylon were holding on to. But God never said life would be easy. He just said we would have life abundantly. So, God is calling us. Are we listening? I want to end with the words of Isaiah chapter 40, 28 through 31. Listen to these words that Isaiah speaks. "Do you not know, have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." Amen. Let's pray. Oh Lord, you want to give us that strength that we've heard about today, that Isaiah had. We know that all we have to do is to ask for it. So, Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit and empower us. And let us desire that strength so that we can use it for you. That wherever we go, we can proclaim that there is still one God in the universe, the God of heaven and earth. And he had a son, Jesus Christ, who came to earth to be one of us, died on a cross, but rose again because he loved us so much. He wanted to forgive our sins and give us the hope of everlasting life. This, Lord, is our prayer today. Amen. Let us stand and sing our final song.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord, I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord.
God's power will come when you ask. Let us pray that God's presence will come down and be on this church as we seek to go out of the four walls and spread God's word to those who need to hear it. Let us pray. O Lord our God, you have called us and we are here. Now empower us, Lord. Take away any fears that we have to allow us to live in this world following you and no other gods, no other things that will come between us and you. We thank you for your presence here today, Lord. Now go with us as we go out into your mission field. And we ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all God's people say, Amen.